I love the word imagination. Dreams are only dreams. Imagination flowing into action is reality.
Don Starkel talked to his two young sons about taking them on a canoe trip. That idea turned into the longest canoe trip in history.
It's the kind of trip most people only dream about. A journey from the cold of Canada to the warmth of Brazil, all by water.
Finally, we were able to look over the Gulf of Mexico. What I saw made me sick with fear.
On May 1st, 1982, father and son, Don and Dana Starkel, made it into the Guinness World Book of Records.
All aboard for the Amazon Hotel. Those were the last words his friends would hear in nearly 2 years.
When we started the trip, I listed, you know, what were the type of things that were going to be the hardest to endure. I think first off, I think I said weather. Then I said insects and bugs. And then I think I said water. We got into Central America, then man went right to the top of the list. And man was our biggest fear. We got permission from the city of Winnipeg to camp in a park in the city. Then all of a sudden CBC television comes down. We didn't want any of this nonsense. And so anyway, so we took off and launched off a sewer pipe. And I remember as soon as half a dozen strokes away, pretty near fell into the river before we got going.
We're now going to the Amazon Hotel.
And it was so embarrassing because all this was on TV. We're going to the Amazon, we can't even get in the river. If you make a mistake on launch, you're in deep trouble because your canoe is going to turn over and you get smashed with big waves, and the waves are powerful.
Waves were 10 and 12 and even higher, 15 feet tall, and there's no way that we could paddle in those conditions.
The canoe, 21 feet long, it went up in the air on a wave. It stood right up on its tail, maybe 1 or 2 degrees from going over like that, and it paused there for about 2 seconds. And I was waiting for that canoe to come down because it was going to break into half a dozen pieces because it was loaded up to 1,000 pounds with us in it. Basically, we were together 24 hours a day almost for 2 years. And the only time we separated, Dana would disappear and then I'd write my diaries. And his first thing was to get to his guitar. I'd finally hear music coming out of the jungle somewhere, Jungle Shore. And I'd walk back there and there he'd be sitting down there serious practicing these pieces. And he did some concerts in an Indian longhouse. And this thing might be 100 feet long, 30 feet high, and 40 feet across, all made of bamboo. Have about 200 people there, these Kuna Indians, and they have a different way of appreciating music. They don't have the same customs. And so when he's playing guitar, you know, he expects some applause or something, and they just don't clap. It's about 9 o'clock at night, and we're in this little stilted shack. I'm listening to the radio, the little red light on my weather band, and all of a sudden the red light flicks off, the noise goes off. I look out the window and this big black cloud is on us and this shack starts shaking, and it was moving, must be moving 5 feet sideways, 5 in swings. And we were screaming, God, stop the wind, stop the wind. And the wind seemed to blow for about an hour or 2 hours. We lay on the floor and the floor was just throwing us all over like this. Then we'd hear water rushing underneath our shack. And then I realized the canoe was out there sitting on the water, and as far as I'm concerned, the canoe was gone. There was nothing in the world that would save that canoe with all that coral. We had about 3 or 4 altercations on the whole trip, and in 2 years, and when you consider all the guns and the frustration, we were trying so hard, and so many people were out there, it seemed like, to get us, and we were fighting about 5 battles at one time. Well, we had a bit of a tussle, and I picked up Dane, I don't know what I did, and I threw him somehow, and he ended up in a, like in a briar patch of some kind with a bunch of thorns and things, and he come out like a prickly pear, and he was mad at me. Son of a gun, walks up to me, picks up our map case, whops me across the face with it, hits my nose, then he took off down the beach like a little whippet. I tried to chase the little son of a gun, I couldn't catch him. He went down there and he started making faces. We slept a year and a half in the open, basically. All through the jungles, on beaches, we slept in rains, in puddles. We had cases where I'd go along, I had a clump of hair in my head, and it took me 2 months, so I finally pull the thing out and in the dark, and I'm trying to unravel this at night, and I find this big beetle running around in my hand, like, you know, and in my palm, and it must have been there for a month or two. We would swear at guys going to blow our heads off, And we'd take our machetes out and start swinging them at them and swearing at them and cursing. And they wanted us to go to beaches. We wouldn't go, and we drove them crazy. They'd turn their motorboat and go roaring off, shaking their head. You know, they call us crazy. And there's one term they yelled at us. The term was Ploma O Vida, lead or life.
I suppose the time when the two brothers were going to execute us in Honduras was the closest we came to being killed, you know, where we really, you know, really very easily could have been killed.
And the guy that had the gun was crying sometimes. Tears were coming to his eyes, and he was screaming, please let me kill him now. And then they took us back, about 100 yards back in the jungle, and the sun was starting to go down. And in a 15-minute period, they had us on our knees three times. I was on my knees, my hands clasped behind my neck like this. And Dana was on his knees. We were elbow to elbow. I was waiting for the gun to go off. And my picture of death was going to be there. I'd hear the gun. I'd see the flash. I'd feel a thump, and everything was going to go black, and that was going to be it. And the thing that bothered me so much, I said, me fine, but my son was 20 years old. I said, but why Dana, you know, why at this young age? I remember Dana saying to me just before we started, he says, you know, Dad, if we do this trip, it has to be our trip. And this was coming from someone quite a bit younger than me, and I said, that was pretty neat. Everything I think they do in their life now, it's affected by that trip. The people they met, the kindnesses they got, how humble you can get, how someone that has absolutely nothing can save your life at times, and it's so humbling.